Hello Internet and welcome to Everwonder. Everyone knows magnets, the metal bars with two poles, north and south, and if you stick two identical poles together, they repel each other, otherwise they will attract and stick together. But why and how does this work? For the most part, a magnet is nothing else than a piece of metal. What turns it into a magnet is the ability to create a magnetic field including the needed flux lines. And with those, we can explain all the types of behavior, because those lines are the actual magnet. But since I want to make it easy, at least in this video, let's start by setting up some rules. 1. The flux lines travel outside the magnet from north to south. The lines always try to travel the shortest and easiest way to their destination. Flux lines repel each other strongly and do not cross. And 4. The more lines an object intersects, the stronger the magnetic force. Now let's start explaining the various types of behavior with this bar magnet. First, we draw in the flux lines applying the declared rules. It's always the fastest way from north to south. And letting the lines repel each other results in the typical layer model with a higher line density at the poles, which means that the poles are much stronger than the sides of the magnet, since you can intersect more lines and therefore get a greater magnetic force. So far so good. But what if I told you that the North Pole doesn't create these flux lines? In reality, they are following a loop in and outside the magnet. Once they enter at the South Pole, they travel inside the metal to the North Pole where they re-emerge. Taking things a step further, this bar isn't really one magnet. I won't go into details like electron spin and so on, maybe in a future video, but the magnet is composed of millions of tiny magnets all pointing in the same direction. That way, the flux lines can travel through. And this is important for the next part. What if you cut a magnet into halves? The answer, you will get two individual complete magnets, not a north and south magnet. Just remember from earlier, the bar magnets are composed of many tiny magnets, even if you cut them. So the field lines will still emerge at the north and enter in the south, regardless of how small you cut them. Now let's put some cubes at the poles, just light enough for them to stick. When we now bring both magnets together again, their flux lines will merge, cancelling out the center poles. This lowers the density of lines in the middle and thus the magnetic force. As a result, the middle cubes will fall off. The next thing I want to explain is how magnets repel and attract. First, repelling. It's easier to understand. If you put two identical poles together, like two north poles, their lines will push against each other. Since they can cross and repel each other, they create a pressure that causes them to be pushed away from each other. Pretty simple so far. But how does attracting work? First, a north and a south pole. Here, some of the lines jump over to the south pole of the other magnet, since it's nearer. This causes this region to experience less pressure than the outer poles, making the magnet move and stick together. This explanation is pretty short and sadly a bit harder to imagine. And how about non-magnetic objects, for example, typical iron? Well, pretty much the same. Once a piece of iron gets near the flux lines, they will travel through it. More on that later. While the lines are traveling through the iron, it becomes a magnet itself, with north and south poles. So the explanation for why it gets attracted is the same. But why do the lines try to travel through iron? And what about the objects that aren't attracted by a magnet? To be honest, it's pretty easy. Just remember our rule. The flux lines always try to go the fastest and easiest way. A vacuum or air has a relative permeability of 1. So the air is our usual medium. Think of it like a normal street for your car. Wood, glass, copper, water, and so on is pretty much the same. All of them are roughly 1. A bit more, a bit less. This means for the flux lines, it's all the same. As if nothing was there. They just go through. What's completely different on the other hand are ferromagnetic materials like cobalt, nickel or iron, with numbers ranging from 250 up to 200,000. These are more like a highway or high-speed train for flux lines. If possible, they go through it, even if it means traveling a long distance. Still, the other direction is possible too, bending the magnetic lines around an object. For this, we only need a permeability of less than 1. Since it's easier for the flux lines to travel through air, it is preferable for them to bend around as long as they reach their destination in a reasonable amount of time, just like choosing between a longer main street and a shorter field road. Examples of materials are the already mentioned water, copper, as well as silver or bismuth. But one extreme case is a superconductor. This would be more like a brick wall, with all the lines traveling around the object. And as you can guess, this can also cause levitation. Since this video would become too long, I think I should make another video about electromagnetism too. So, see you in the next video. Have a good one.